And the title of my talk is The Media and the Message, Russian Sensibility in Putin's Times. As a Russian citizen, I'm often getting asked different kinds of questions on the current situation in Russia and its different aspects, political, legal, moral. And there is a brand of a question I consider my favorite. It is, so to say, prognostic one. In fact, I was asked it just 2 days ago while giving a reading at Portland. And the question is, well, and what will happen next? What will come out of it all? And it's a hard question to face, and not being a sociologist or a futurologist, I can only wave my hands. But there is also an opportunity to tell a joke. I've been told once that it is considered to be bad taste in Germany to start a talk or a reading with a joke. But since we're in US, I'll tell one. It goes like that. Someone also asks a question, and the question is, can a woman become a president of Russia? And the answer is technically yes, practically no. Why? Because Putin is not a woman. So, seems that if Russia's future was predictable and the Russian authorities stick to this notion, we would have ages and ages of Putin's regime. There is one more joke about it. Putin is asked to write his testament, and he hesitates, then he thinks it over, then he says, well, why not? And then he leaves everything to Vladimir Putin. But we know that there is nothing predictable about the future, and especially in Russia, and that's the focal point of a few thoughts I'm going to share with you. Not being a scholar, what I can offer is a mix of a report and a testimony. In the last 20 years, I was deeply involved in what was happening in the Russian media field. The big changes it was suffering, some of them involuntary and some a result of constant efforts of the Russian state, are mirroring the changes in a way that Russian society is seeing itself and its place in the world. These changes are multi-layered, and they have completely transformed our notions of journalism as both a product and a profession, and they affect everyone. Nonetheless, the Russian situation is entirely unique. I will try briefly to explain in the hopes that my unhappy experience can serve to help understanding the general whole, the heterogeneous unity that makes up our contemporary world. I often have to think and to speak about the systemic crisis that independent media outlets in Russia are facing. In contrast to the tectonic shifts that are happening in the Western media, this crisis is 100% man-made. It's a result of a number of deliberate efforts of calculated policy, which over the 15 years of the Putin's regime has led to a more or less total substitution of classical media outlets by phantom or sham television channels, newspapers, or internet project. The sole objective of which is to imitate the existence of a free press under unfree conditions. Even now, against a backdrop of political and economic crisis, so much money is invested in the creation of these projects that it could fund a budget for a small state. As a Brezhnev-era ideologue Mikhail Suslov once said, we don't skimp on ideology. In this way, as in so many others, the reality of Putin's Russia are a parodic copy of its predecessor, the Soviet Union. The methods used to destroy the independent press are designed to dismantle, one by one, any and all publications that could compete with the phantom media. There is a term I would prefer to use speaking of these matters, and it comes from the times of the Chechen War, the first Chechen campaign. It is the term zachistka. I guess lots of you know the word. And it means a total and complete demolition of every form of human life on a territory that the authorities are considering to be dangerous. 15 years have passed since the destruction of NTV, that was the leading independent television channel of the 90s. And in the meantime, the biggest TV channels, publications, or even entire publishing houses has been shut down or forcibly reformed. How it was working? There is an example of Kommersant. As you know, the oldest and the most respectable independent publication in post-Soviet Russia. It was enjoying an impeccable reputation for over 20 years. But in 2007, the previous owners sold it to Alisher Usmanov, an oligarch with no former interest in the media field. And for almost 5 years, things were going on, and the editorial policy and the figures were staying the same. Then, in a short time, from December 2011 to 2013, the publication was going through a number of shock treatments, sacking of editors and general managers, closing or reshaping successful projects, pressing journalists to omit this and that, and effectively destroying the whole thing. Now the publication is, so to say, sufficiently loyal and hardly reliable. Now the state is focusing on a new and complex task and attempting to control the internet. The real picture of what has happened is this. Media has essentially ceased to be a business in Russia. For the owners and investors, the risks associated with such dangerous properties are outweighing the financial and reputational gain. The owners are looking to divest themselves of their media concerns, and they are making now strategic and personnel decisions without even taking into account the business component. The same thing is happening to a journalism education and also with the entire system of humanities education, but it's much more wide topic. But the system of journalism education is as good as destroyed, and the professional standards are eroding or being done away with. State media outlets essentially embrace the yellow press in every sense, organizationally, stylistically, and ideologically. There is also an impressive example, and it is a story of the Life News, the yellow paper and a TV channel that for the last few years was sharing the managing and the working space and the sources and even the journalists sometimes with the Izvestia, a formerly respectable daily newspaper that now for a few years was managed by Aram Gabrielyanov, an interesting person, a founder of the biggest yellow media outlet in Russia, and the guy who is always parading his loyalty to the authorities in a kind of Kadyrov fashion. He was saying something like, I'll kill everyone for Putin or something along the same lines. The media outlets that are controlled by Gabrielyanov are known for publishing slivy bits of information that the special services want to spread around. And in the same time, laws are being adopted at many levels that make a journalist's work impossible. There are laws on revealing sources, laws against foreigners working in the media, laws on foreign agents, and laws on undesirable organizations. Their name is Legion. But what is now at stake above all is the internet, and first and foremost, the social networks, which now fulfill the function of the news media, when real media outlets cannot fulfill their functions professionally. But with everything I have detailed or tried to detail, there is the worst type of defamation that can happen in journalism and to journalists. And it is an internal defamation. In Soviet times, it was called the inner editor, an inner hidden entity that is responsible for taking the serious decisions or mostly preventing you from saying anything that may be considered dangerous. It is, of course, a form of self-censorship, but a more subtle and discreet. It is a shaky moral situation when the decision whether to report facts has to be made anew every time, and you are weighing not only the reliability of your sources and the importance of the information you have gotten, but also the problems that the publication of dangerous information can create for your media and its employees. You are always thinking, you are always asking yourself a number of questions. Won't they shut down the site, or fire the editor-in-chief, or make him sack the journalist who is writing the piece, or, in the new media field, all that can happen to you at once. As a result, journalists and editors don't even need to be controlled by the presidential administration, because they are already censoring themselves. They are constructing a difficult balance of truths, half-truths, and silences, where there should be a single task, like finding and reporting information. A second arises, and it is a contradictory one. Interesting information is something dangerous. It is something threatening. It needs to be concealed, or at least meted out in small doses. And what it means is, today, every Russian publication, especially the ones that are working with social or political subjects, is risking several things. It could be instantly blocked without a court verdict if the content of your site could be considered extremist. You could be called a foreign agent if what you are doing is considered to be a political activity. It could be anything like writing an article on the problems of the army or, of course, on the elections. You could be sued by the authorities or even private persons if your content is viewed as obscene or worse, propagating homosexuality, which is a kind of a bête noire for the regime and its supporters. And of course, you could be suffocated financially by a number of penalties, by costly legal proceedings, or simply with putting more pressure on the owners. And the worst of it, to censor yourself constantly in order to avoid or minimize the previous risks. In this way, the entire media system as a whole is ailing. It is just that some are corrupted by money and power, and the others fall victim to constant external arm twisting and internal censorship. What is interesting for me is, what does this situation mean for the West and for the Russia? Because now people are starting to think about the West and the Russia as about the direct opposites. It was different 10 years ago, for example. So what does it mean for the West? That all the information people are getting here from Russia, from the official or even unofficial sources, needs to be subjected to a careful reading and corrective. And above all, this affects the main information bubble of recent years. I mean the myth of massive support for Putin, the notion that Putin and Russia are one and the same. I mean millions and billions were spent to convince the West of this. And the reality is far from being so straightforward. But, of course, now we're having fewer and fewer opportunities to see this. What does this situation mean for Russia? That in the very close future, there will be almost no remaining sources of information that could be trusted. And this against the backdrop of a mass societal depression, a growing economic crisis, and the complete lack of any prospects for the future. In essence, the country could return soon to Soviet standards, to times when the only way to find out what is happening in the country and the world was to look for hidden meanings in the official publications. The only thing that can counteract this in my opinion, is a system of free partisan media outlets. Because the authorities, as the experience of the last 15 years demonstrates, have their own logic of reaction. And they first go after everything big, judging mainly by audience numbers. They go after everything that caves under direct pressure. Ideally speaking, for the state, media has to be equaled to an owner, and the owner may be controlled or needs to be replaced. But some publications that haven't been roped into the smooth system of briefings and agreements, that don't participate in the presidential administration meetings, kind of fall outside the authorities' comfort zone. And to put it bluntly, they'd rather not notice them. And now, the balance of power is shifting. There are small news-style outlets with small budgets, small staffs, with a limited menu of services. Often they are existing as and with a legal status of individual blogs. And they are on the leading edge, in the front row, so to speak, or at the frontier. They have no masters. They have comparatively small audiences. They are diversified. Each one is trying to reach its own relatively sparse niche audience. But the total audience of this eclectic group of sites is very, very big. And it is also united by the mistrust for the official sources of information. Broadly speaking, the audience of this internet archipelago is made up of that official 14%, although there is reason to assume that there were many more than that. And it is an interesting topic we don't have now time to discuss. Could we rely on straightforward sociology in a totalitarian country that it is obsessed with hiding the truth? I've just read a news piece saying that 70% of the Russians admitted they're lying to sociologists. And the other 30% just didn't admit it yet. So that 14% that didn't support Putin in the last elections, that subset of Russians who are politically conscious and active and ready for a productive dialogue with the rest of the world, are the readership of that limited but active and bright number of partisan publications. And it's a fairly new thing, because I guess that for the first time in 2.5 decades, independent journalism in Russia lacks a flagship publication. And if one appeared, its days would be limited because it would be marked as an enemy number one. And it demands, this new situation is something that demands work and responsibility from the reader, who is simultaneously an interpreter. And it also demands effort to preserve the little that remains of Russian media. It could become the beginning of a new phase. Sorry. I had a long journey, and I still have to get my English back in command. But contemporary Russia is very much ambiguous about beginnings, about any kind of beginnings, and this is another layer of our complicated reality. There is this big global framework you can use to view our local situation. What I mean is that everywhere, not only in Russia, the future, the whole concept of the future, is not no more what it used to be. It is no more something to aim for, or something to build up together, or even something to hope for. In the best way possible, it is simply blank, and sometimes threatening. I was looking, preparing for to write some article, some essay, through the American box offices for the last 25 years. And the thing that seems to me striking is that the last extra popular movie that deals with the future, not presenting it as a nightmare, was Back to the Future. And it is 25 years ago. And now what we're having is a number of differently arranged catastrophes. So the feeling is more or less common. But in Russia, the common feeling is much more intense and I guess more widely spread and more universal. This is a feeling that everyone agrees on. It is a point of an unnamed consensus. From Putin to the opposition, from peasants to intellectual, to the intellectual strata, future is something to be afraid of, something to be avoided at any possible price. And the interesting thing is, how did it come to that? What could call into existence that sort of a common consensus? It is unnamed. We hide it even from ourselves, but it still exists and unites all the levels of contemporary Russian society. This fear of the future, the agreement that it will only make things worse, helps maybe to answer the crucial question. How comes there is no Maidan in Russia? Why did the opposition stop where it did in 2012? But the most urgent question that needs to be answered is a different one. What happened to the idea of future? What's so wrong with it? And here is a few explanations that may help maybe. I was telling my friends for a year about a brilliant and yet unpublished paper of a psychologist I was lucky to read back in Moscow. She's working in a field of post-Freudian analysis. And she works in Moscow. She has a wide practice. Her prices are considerably low, so her clientele is somewhat representative. There are different ages, different circles, different educational or social levels. And what is striking, and it's quite obvious in her work, is how much alike, how in fact homogeneous these people and their feelings are, and in one very special way. The work of an analyst is to listen to other people's dreams. And that's what she's doing. And what is remarkable is that for the last 10 years, there is basically just one dream she's hearing, just one story she's dealing with. There is a common plot with little individual twists and turns, but the story stays the same. She quotes or retells quite a number, and I'm going to retell you just one that impressed me the most. The narrator, the one who is telling the story, is the dreamer, is a girl. She's in her 30s. She's quite well-to-do. She works as a copywriter at some advertising agency. She lives in Moscow. She has a boyfriend. And the dream is the authorities are issuing a new law, which is saying that anyone who is to lose his passport is to be executed, to be effectively killed. And what the girl says is, I'm always the unlucky one. That kind of thing is something that always happening to me. I lose my passport immediately. And I go home and tell about it to my family. Everyone is crying. My boyfriend threatens to kill himself. My sister is weeping. But my mom, she's the wise one in the family. She says, don't worry. It is not as bad as it seems. They will not kill you. They will just send you into an exile. And that's exactly what is happening. Buzz, the doorbell rings, and the firing squad is entering, and they're bringing me away. But yes, Mom was right, they didn't kill me. They're putting me in a Skotsky wagon. It is a train carriage that was used in Stalin's era for transporting big numbers of prisoners to the faraway lagers, the concentration camps. And the carriages are basically empty. There are no seats, of course, no benches, no nothing, no windows, or they are closed with woodwork, but you can see something if you're gaping into a hole. And I'm sitting at the floor of that Skotsky wagon, trying to see something, and what I'm seeing is endless white fields in the window. They never end. There is nothing, no houses, no towns, just this white nothing passing by, and we are going further and further, and I realize that I could knew it all along. I always knew it, that my happy childhood, my toys, my first kiss, my school years, my mom's fairy tales, everything was just a passing fancy, something unreliable and unreal. And these things, that whiteness in the window and that the rough wood I am sitting at, that Skotsky wagon, that nothing I am approaching, is a real thing. It's something that I was born for. This thing is quite impressive, at least for me. And it comes in a number of versions. And sometimes mother is a traitor, not just one who helps a dreamer to understand how to do in the new situation. And sometimes mother is a killer, but she's never the one who saves you. And what it means, I guess, that at the very roots of our everyday existence lies a deep belief that the reality is something you cannot rely at. Under each surface, there is an ugly sub-reality of what may happen, some real thing that always means the same treachery and death. Every turn of your life, every new turn can lead you to total disintegration. And that's what the dreams are saying. You can never rely on anything, even or especially on your loved ones. In the dream world, mother, that means also motherland, of course, never hesitates to betray you or kill you. And, well, it's quite an explanation for anyone to wish to postpone the future for the longest time possible. Even if you are understanding on your conscious level that it is a simple mental construct, a result of decades and decades of lasting trauma that no one was really working with, it is just too deeply rooted to be dismissed. So if you live in Russia, what you feel is you have no future, and even your present is deeply, and that even if your present is deeply flawed and compromised, if you need to choose between them, you sure take the present. And that takes us straight to that informal pact with the Putin's dogma that makes people wish the history to end. And as you remember, the story is not new, but when Alexander Kojève was speaking of the end of history and that eternal, everlasting present, he was meaning something completely different. What he was saying is the state is to become so effective in terms of solving problems, fulfilling needs of its citizens, that the state and the citizen are making a pact, thus permitting the history to stop. In a way, this vision is grotesquely similar to that hidden pact that exists between the Russian state and its citizenship. But our pact is revised. It has a different base. What is said, it is not that everything is perfect, so let's stop the clock. It might become much worse, so let's stop the clock. The state may be faulted or even failed, but we still agree to leave it like that, to prevent the further yet unknown catastrophe. But the present time we are experiencing now is so ugly, we are still unable to face it. So we turn to the only thing that still seems stable, the time past. and what we see there is also unpredictable. From the Russian point of view, the past is a matter of fiction. It is never something stable or solid. It is subject to constant changes and revisions. After the 70 years of Soviet official history, i.e. of rewriting the big narrative to make it serve the current situation, after all that generations of erased memory, demolished portraits, rewritten textbooks, whatever, we know our lesson well enough. It is that history is also unreliable. There is nothing final about it. It is never about the truth. It's about what they want you to say right now. And under the grand flow of the official history coming from the Soviet era lie the deeper currents of another secret history that was kept in the family. But you never know which story to choose. At that point, history becomes your story of choice. It is turning to into literature. For now, there is no point, no spot in the whole history of Russia, Soviet or pre-Soviet, that could unite all the people and become a base for a big consensus. A historical name or a date or a concept that would mean exactly the same for all the people. It is not Yeltsin, not Gorbachev, not Lenin, not Stalin, not the Second World War, not even Catherine the Great. And definitely it is not the perestroika or revolution. The past is a battlefield. It is always revisited and revised. And comically or tragically, I don't know, the last point of such a revisal is the story of decembrists that are traditionally viewed by centuries as heroes, someone who was struggling to save the country from slavery. And now they are almost officially treated as traitors, as the foreign agents, as one can see, for instance, at a brand new exhibition at the State Historical Museum on the Red Square. But still the past, multi-layered and fragile as it is the only narrative we can refer to. It's the only mirror we can face. So it is becoming something different, a postmodern or even post-conceptual fiction, a starting point for different remixes, collages, exercises in style, a source of false, empty of any meaning examples. How it works really is very visible in the official media. You see something that feels like a quotation, but you never know if it is forged or not. And you don't know where does it come from. Maybe from the 30s, maybe from the 70s, maybe the guy is quoting Pravda, maybe the Sturmer. There is only one thing you can be sure, that the author doesn't know it too. And he doesn't really care. He simply thinks it sounds good. There is that mantra that everything is relative. There is no truth. The authorities are referring to it when they are trying to transcribe, to rebuild, to reconstruct the big Russian past, the grand Russian past. It is, in fact, a patchwork of misquotations and false evidence. It is hybrid, as the war in Ukraine was, and it has nothing to do with the truth. But they insist now that the whole concept of truth is old-fashioned. And this version of the past, totally artificial one, is a picture of future that the Russian state is promising to its people. I think that the obsession with the past is something very deep and private. I also am subject to that kind of feeling. But what I'm deeply sure in is that our only chance of getting ourselves a future or even a present is to stop with the past, to make ourselves part with the past, and to force ourselves to see that the future, unknown as it is, still is inevitable, whether we want it or not. Thank you.